In this video, I'm going to go through a few examples and show you the number of stall cycles introduced both without and with bypassing. So I'm just going to take a pair of instructions and see, you know, what delays I need to introduce between these two instructions. And you'll always see that, you know, one instruction produces a result, in this case, in register $1, and the second instruction is consuming the value that was produced by the earlier instruction. Okay, so for any pair of producers and consumers, I'm trying to figure out what are the gaps I need to introduce. So let's start by assuming that there is no bypassing. That means all inputs come from the register file. And you'll see that I've kind of flipped the figure that I showed you earlier. Now I'm showing you, you know, one instruction that goes from left to right in terms of time and the units that it's going through. And you'll see that this kind of depiction is a little easier to reason about stall cycles. So I1 essentially goes through all these stages and produces a result in $1 in the first half of cycle 5. Let's look at the second instruction here, right? At what point does it retrieve the value of $1? That's going to happen in the register read stage. So for this to work correctly, we know that a register read at this point will correctly get the right value of $1. Okay, so somehow instruction 2 has to delay its register read until this cycle over here, right? So instruction 2 does its fetch here, does a register read over here that fails, tries a register read again over here that fails, and then succeeds in doing the correct read of $1 from the register file, and then it proceeds along. Okay, so I1 finishes in this cycle, nothing finishes in this cycle, nothing finishes in this cycle, and then I2 finishes in this cycle down here. Okay, so that means we are introducing two stall cycles between I1 and I2 in this case, right? So without bypassing, I will have two stall cycles. And in the next few slides, I'm going to go through two other examples. The results in those cases will also be two stall cycles. And that's because when you don't have bypassing, the point of production of a value, right, the point when I produce a value that can be consumed, is always in the first half of this register write stage. So the producer always produces a result at that point. So that's the point of production. And the consumer is always going to read a value in this register read stage. So for every consumer, this is the point of consumption. And so we're going to line up the two instructions so that the point of consumption happens right after the point of production, right? That's the shortest gap between these two instructions. And that means I need to stall I2 by two cycles, as you've seen here. Okay, so if you don't have bypassing, regardless of the instruction type, you will always have this two cycle gap between two instructions. So now I'm going to put aside this case with no bypassing, and I'll only focus on the case with bypassing. Okay, but before that, I should also just clarify that this computation or this estimate of two stall cycles is specific to this pipeline. If I give you a different pipeline, and if I come up with, you know, some new architecture where instructions produce and consume values at different points of time, then these numbers might change. Okay, so this answer is specific to this particular example. All right, so now let's put aside the case with no bypassing, and let's focus on just figuring out the stall cycles when I have a processor with bypassing or forwarding. And now these different instructions or these different examples will have different points of production, different points of consumptions, and accordingly, the stall cycles will change. Okay, so let's look at this example again. What is the earliest time that I know the value of $1? That is known right after I've done the addition of $2 plus $3, right? So this is the point of production for this add instruction. Now let's look at the load instruction. At what point do I need the value of $1? Okay, so this instruction, if I assume that it starts in cycle 2 and just basically moves ahead without any stall cycles, then it's in this ALU stage over here that I'm going to be doing $1 plus 8, right? So I need the value of $1 right before I enter the ALU stage. So this is my point of consumption. And thankfully, you know, without having to do anything special, it turns out that the point of consumption is after the point of production, right? So this value, which is sitting in this latch here, which is latch L4, can directly be routed to the input of the ALU, right? So these two instructions can indeed start in back-to-back cycles, and they can finish in back-to-back cycles, and I didn't have to do anything special. The data dependencies were handled correctly by forwarding the result that is sitting in latch L4. Okay, so in this case, there are zero stall cycles and by passing was able to remove the two stall cycles that were introduced when I did not have bypassing, right? So that's the benefit of bypassing. I was able to save the two cycle gap between the producer and the consumer. Let's look at the second example. So here, the producer is reading something from data memory and producing a value that will eventually be stored in register $1. So the point of production is actually down here. So what's happening in the ALU stage? The ALU stage is doing $2 + 8. And that's not the result of this instruction. That's just the address that I'm going to use to fetch something from data memory, right? $2 + 8 is not something that I pass on to my consuming instructions, right? So this is really not the point of production. That's the place where I compute the address. That address is used by the data memory stage to look up the value sitting in that memory location, right? So that value could be, say, the number 80. That is then going to come out of the data memory stage and is eventually going to be written into $1. But on its way to $1, it's going to be stored in latch L5. Okay, so the true result that gets placed in $1 is the number 80 in this example, and that value 80 is known as early as the end of this data memory stage, right? So that's my point of production. So now let's assume that this consuming instruction began in the very next cycle and started to flow through the pipeline. What is its point of consumption? At what point does it need the value $1? If it had just flown through the pipeline as always, it would have shown up at the ALU stage and performed $1 + 8. So I need the value of $1 at the start of my ALU stage. So this is my point of consumption. So you'll see that this does not quite work out, right? This is an instruction which is consuming the value before the value was even produced. So starting these instructions in back-to-back cycles and having them go through the pipeline without any stalls is not going to work. So what happens to this instruction? It starts out here, so I2 starts out here. It goes to the decode and register read stage. And at this point, the decode unit is smart enough to know that the value of $1 is not going to be available if I were to jump into the ALU stage in the next cycle. So the decode stage is smart enough to hold this instruction back. So in cycle 3, that instruction, I2, remains in the decode stage. It spends one additional cycle over there. And at this point, the decode stage says, you know, now I think it's safe for me to move ahead because the value of I1 has now been produced. So I2 moves ahead here. And this is where it's now going to try and consume the value $1. Thankfully, this is later in time than the point of production. So now I can actually get the value of I1 from latch L5, and I can now proceed. So then I2 just basically goes ahead and finishes up. So there's an instruction completing at this point of time. I2 completes at this point of time. And in between, we have a stall cycle because I had to essentially take my point of consumption and shift it one place to the right so that it falls after the point of production. Right? So in this example, there will be one stall cycle. And intuitively, you can see, you know, why that's the case. In our earlier example, an add instruction was producing a result at the end of the ALU stage. And now my value is being produced one cycle later, and so any consumers who want that value have to kind of be delayed by at least one more cycle, right? So that's kind of the intuitive reason why there's one stall cycle here. It's because a load takes longer to produce its result. Now let's look at this third example. So again, a load is going to produce its result at this point, right? So $1 has a point of production that is at the end of the data memory stage. Let's look at the second consuming instruction, which is a store. And stores are tricky because they have two different registers that they need to read, and they consume these values at different points in time. Okay, so if you look at $3, at what point do I need the value $3? It's when I compute the address, which is in the ALU stage. So if you assume that the second instruction starts out in the second cycle and just proceeds through the pipeline without any stalls, then $3 + 8 happens in the third stage, which means that I need the value of $3 at the start of this ALU stage. So this is my point of consumption for $3. What about $1? So $1 is the value that I'm going to put into the data memory unit, right? So once I've computed the address $3 + 8, I'm going to use that address, identify a location here, and I'm going to put the value of $1 into that location. right? So I need the value $1 over here. So this is the point of consumption for $1. So if the producer is producing $1, then I need to make sure that the point of production happens before the point of consumption for $1 here. If instead the value being produced here is feeding into this ALU unit, then I might end up with a different number of stall cycles, right? So we really need to look at what the example is. In this case, the value I'm consuming is $1, which is being used to store into the data memory unit, right? So this is kind of what I care about. And thankfully, this point of consumption is after the point of production. So these two instructions can indeed start out in back-to-back cycles and proceed without any stall cycles. So this instruction finishes here, this instruction finishes here. I have zero stall cycles in this example. Just to wrap up this discussion, let me also take this other case into account. Let's say that this was actually producing a result into $3, right? In that case, how many stall cycles would I see, right? So this is the point of production for $3. We've already seen that this is the point of consumption for $3. This is the point of consumption for $1. Okay, and in this case, since $3 is the value being exchanged between the producer and the consumer, you know, this is not going to work out, right? We can't consume it before the value has actually been produced. So the second instruction has to shift one place to the right. Okay, so there will be one stall cycle. So that's the answer in that case. And I2 starts out here, goes to the decode stage. The decode stage figures out that I need to delay this instruction by a cycle. So I do decode yet one more time. Then I move on to the ALU stage where I'm going to compute $3 plus 8. And now the value gets communicated correctly from the producer to the consumer. And then I carry on. So instruction 1 finishes here, instruction 2 finishes here, and I have a stall cycle between those two. Okay, so depending on what the instruction types are, depending on how the pipeline is, depending on where the point of production is and where the point of consumption is, you may have a different number of stall cycles between the first producing instruction and the second consuming instruction.